CTV. Just to go over the agenda for tonight, we'll have Selectmen liaison reports, public comment, town manager's report. We are going to then move into approving the town manager's contract, talk about Birch Road utility easement, abandoned drainage easements for 21 Hunt Street and 26 Lee Street. We'll have a public hearing around 7:30 for driveway waiver, 43 Track Road. At 7:45, we'll preview the September 12th special town meeting warrant, and then at 8 o'clock, probably go into the meatier part of the agenda, which is talking about senior tax relief. We'll have approval of minutes, and no executive session tonight, I don't think. So, so that said, we'll start off with liaison reports. Mr. Arena, to my right.
Thanks, Barry. I had the pleasure last night of being flamingoed, and I'd learned about 11:30 last night when I saw the many orange plastic flamingos in my front yard, along with a sign from E-Mark. It's a kind of a clever way to do fundraising and get awareness for their organization. It's got two interesting features if you haven't had it yet. One is you can make a donation to the group, which is always fun. And two is for that donation, you get to pick the next individual to get flamingos. So I had the pleasure of nominating Joan and Dan Ensminger. So
I knew it.
But you get to pick the next. So
okay.
You could pick John right back.
Yeah. I could. That's true. Well, thanks. And so my report's the same. It's a great cause, so I would urge everyone to, whether you're flamingoed or not.
So basically, you get flamingoed. If you make the donation, they take the flamingos off?
They do. They have a whole crew that comes out and places them. They will remove them, and you can buy flamingo insurance. It's a little protection racket.
So you don't get flamingoed.
That's right. That's right.
They caution you to allow the flamingo technical assistance and only them to remove them.
Oh, okay. All right. And of course, they're paying union wages.
I didn't get into that.
Absolutely funny, particularly
sure,
if you have no idea what it is. You know, normally you see pumpkins or shaving cream or toilet paper. What are these things doing in my yard?
Thanks, Sean. That was a nice touch.
That's great.
All right.
I don't have much to report I can remember, other than I think a meeting that all of us were there that I thought was really helpful.
Sorry, buddy.
That's all right.
Communication with the babysitter.
That's all right. All of us attended the zoning charrette last week, where we discussed with CPDC some of the different zoning changes potentially for the downtown. And I was shocked and awed and pleased that we had probably like 50 people on a on a nice summer night that delved into zoning maps. So I thought there was some really good discussion, some really good input about some of the zoning changes that potentially can come forward that would create some development parcels downtown to support businesses and really to kind of create some economic development. So a lot of faces I hadn't seen before, which I thought was good. So I think that there's a lot of interest in kind of working our economic development plan forward from lots of new and different people. So I was pleasantly pleased, pleasantly surprised.
Just a quick follow-up to that, Barry. After the meeting closed, there were a number of sidebars which went on fairly late, but some of the developers at the meeting had comments that they either chose to or preferred not to make public, mostly in terms of not wanting to, I think, take issue with the plan because it was a first attempt and they didn't want to react so quickly after it being presented. But there were a number of interesting ideas that came out of those sidebars, and it might be worth the board entertaining a discussion with the development community to get specifically their inputs, not just the abutters, not merely those that have been doing the work.
I think that's key. I mean, we're going through the whole aggravation and torturous process of changing zoning laws, which require tons and tons of staff time and meeting time, to basically hone the tools. And if the people who are going to be actually doing the building are telling us that what we're trying to do might not be good enough, I think it's really incumbent upon us to listen and get that input and just, create the right tool to do the right job. And so I wholeheartedly agree on that.
If you do zoning in the absence of input from the development committee, it sometimes leads to a result that's never used. And I think we had that experience down in Walker's Brook Drive with the PUD that we wrote for actually an office park development. And it turned out that Home Depot and who else is there? Jordan's never used that provision. They just went in under the underlying zoning. And had we maybe talked to more of the commercial side.
Exactly.
Yeah.
We're all doing the right thing, want to do the right thing, but those guys live it, and I'd like to hear what they think.
If I might, I talked to Chairman Halsey about that right after the meeting. He would have shared that. I'll do his liaison report.
Okay.
He agreed, and we've actually tentatively scheduled an October workshop again with CPDC, and we're going to invite in a handful of developers. And we have officially, formally postponed any 40R article going to November town meeting to get that input.
Yeah. Okay.
Whether or not there's going to be any change, it was clearly incumbent on the Board of Selectmen to basically direct CPDC to do anything different than what the current zoning is, that it wasn't CPDC's perceived purview to do that. So, you know, we agreed at a minimum that, you know, delaying by a few months of town meeting and getting input for developers was a really good idea.
Yep.
And then hopefully by then, October, we might have our community development planner on board. That will also maybe help lead some of those discussions.
Yep.
And,
sure.
That could be good. I mean, it's better to do it right than to do it fast.
Side and haste, repent and leisure.
Did everybody already get there?
We're liaised.
Reports?
You're fully liaised.
And I have no other reports other than the meeting that we were just speaking of. Next up, we have public comment. Yes, Erin.
Hi, Erin Calvobaci, 494 Main Street. And I have been notified on Facebook that the Board of Selectmen has a plan to attract, retain, and support retailers, and I'd love to hear more about that.
I don't know if we have per se a plan to support. I know we've talked about it a lot as a board, and some of the things, such as that meeting with the CPDC, was basically built around, you know, how do we make Reading a more attractive place for projects to come into town that, you know, would help out from an economic development standpoint. So I don't think we actually have a plan in place so much, you know, on paper as far as step by step how we go about doing that. So you said you saw it on Facebook?
Yes.
Okay.
And with 5 storefronts empty in Reading right now, as a retail advocate, it's very concerning to me that what are we doing to attract the businesses? And with the climate, I want the board to understand that the legislative climate for retailers is very tumultuous and really challenging. It's actually every reason why I had sold my retail store and moved to an online presence for myself. So given that we are looking at possible zoning changes that would encourage more retail, that's why it's very much of the utmost interest and importance to me to know what the town is looking at.
Well, I think that one of them, really the key piece of supporting retail downtown is changing the zoning that will allow more mixed-use parcels in the downtown area. One of the complaints that I've talked to, and I've talked to local businesses, is that 80% of the people who have jobs in Reading leave the town during the day to go elsewhere to work, and so during the day there's not a lot of activity. So if we can create a vibrant downtown with more people living there, that creates the demand for more of the ancillary businesses. It kind of creates more of a flow. So I think that would be a huge boon for local downtown businesses if we have more people living down there full time.
But excuse me, to your point where you said if people living here don't work here and they're leaving, where's the guarantee that those
there's no guarantee, right?
I know that. So that's the only reason why I'm trying to draw attention to that.
So I mean, if we're creating more people downtown, it's creating a demand for the businesses. Maybe you'll see a change in the composition of businesses. You mentioned 5 storefronts that are vacant. One of them is a yogurt store, which already had a yogurt store around the block. One of them was a wine store. We already had a wine store around the block. So it's not so much that maybe that the downtown that we're not supporting local businesses. It could be that the composition of local businesses isn't done, and then the market will determine that. So,
but to that, if you're talking about competition, we have two Starbucks in Reading and multiple Dunkin' Donuts that seem to be doing fine. So I am of the belief that competition is good. But now another thing in regards to supporting the businesses, there is a sign on the common. Couldn't that help promote Dine, Shop Local, something very much like the electronic billboard in Wakefield, what Wakefield does for its downtown businesses?
Well, if you haven't caught up to what's going on with our planners, shoot Gene a quick email.
Okay.
The thing out there historically was agreed to from the Historic Commission, who has jurisdiction, it was for nonprofits only. So I've been back and forth with Leslie Leahy over the last month or so, and I'm sure you know. And we can't put a generic sign that's not promoting a specific event. So if the chamber wanted to promote, you know, Fall Street Fair, these merchants are having this deal, that'd be fine. But to just, even for the chamber as a nonprofit, to put Shop Local, no, not allowed.
What's the distinction?
Yeah, what's the
I'm not seeing the distinction.
It's an agreement with the Historical Commission because they have jurisdiction over the town.
So what about bringing historic? Excuse me. What about bringing historic in? Since I know when I was part of the Shop the Block.
The other part of this is if you talk to Jean, she's working on a whole signage program for the downtown and Haven Street area. So she's got mock-ups to make everyone. One of the things that happens anecdotally is you drive by Main Street, you don't even know Haven Street's there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's plenty of people that live elsewhere that commute that don't know. I know I have friends that had that. So we're trying to improve the visibility and make sure, markets or whatever the thing is, she's got a lot of mock-ups of signs so that Main Street is visually more appealing and public parking is more readily identified. Because if you did happen to wander down Haven Street, unless you know where the old Atlantic was and where that lot is, good luck finding it, because the signage is not great.
Yeah.
So now, is there other within? Is there a place to go other than just emailing Jean that you can see what these different?
I would suggest emailing because she can send you the mock-ups. That's the best way.
Okay, I was just thinking in terms of letting other people know what's going on.
It's still at the staff level work, so she hasn't brought it to any so-called nighttime government. But I'm sure I saw one today. I'm sure she'd be happy to share it.
Is there any format, Bob, for the involvement of the retailers if they wanted to put their...
She is working with, I forget, what's the group, Downtown something?
Downtown Retailers Association,
yeah.
And Andy Chico,
yeah,
marking
been,
up the signs.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you.
Is there any other public comment?
I attended three meetings.
Would you state your name and address?
James Martin, 245 Charles Street.
Thank you.
I attended the three listening sessions for the Proposition 2.5 override.
Yep.
Is there a draft of that question available now?
Not yet. No, there's not a draft of the question available.
We haven't debated that yet.
Yeah.
We'll be talking about that in our August 9th meeting in detail.
So not any specifics.
We have to discuss the form and the number of the questions. We haven't done that yet.
Yeah, I have some concerns about how the process is going, so I'm doing some research on it now. So
you want to share your concerns?
Yeah, I want to know why we're not having the election in conjunction with the presidential election.
Bob?
I don't want to answer that off the cuff, but we examined both the state primary and the presidential. And one of the main concerns was the town clerk could not find enough poll workers because you have to doubly staff an election that's
right.
Essentially two elections. She could barely find staffing for one election sometimes.
It's my understanding from the Secretary of State's office that question could be incorporated in the federal ballot and the state ballot as well.
It can, but
again, as a practical matter, she was concerned that she wouldn't be able to find staffing. Literally would not have enough.
No, that'd be just one election then, he's saying. It could be one of the
That's not what we've heard from the state.
Oh, really?
No. You have to have two ballots, if you will. You can't put it on the federal, is what we've heard.
Secretary of State's office said that it can be on that ballot.
The Attorney General said no. And town council said no. So.
And we asked.
We did ask.
We did ask.
Okay.
We asked last winter.
I'm just concerned because of the way that the library thing went down. We had two debt exclusions. The election seemed to coincide with Jason Lewis's run for office, and then there was the first one was prior to that, and then the second one. So I think these things are being manipulated to reduce.
That's categorically untrue, sir.
Yeah, they're not being manipulated. I can assure you that. It's more of a practical matter.
A number of people are discussing this in town and wondering why we're not putting it on the ballot with most of the people will show up.
There are valid reasons, valid legal reasons, and logistical reasons for not doing it.
Is it worth putting a call into the Secretary of State for whatever value that query might have?
But if we were going to do that.
We got unequivocal legal advice last winter, because we started thinking about the planning of this about a year ago.
It wouldn't be the first time two branches of the state have different answers to the same question, but it'd be worth asking.
I thought we had a discussion in a prior meeting that it could be done, but the form of the question would have to be known sometime in July. So it could be.
Well, that was part of the.
August 3rd.
August 3rd.
It can be incorporated into that ballot if it's presented to the state by August 3rd.
I'm inclined to agree with the gentleman here.
Even if it could, what we heard was you're going to need double election workers.
That's if you have two ballots.
Two ballots. We're talking about including it as a ballot question.
That's not how it came to us last winter.
You would have to check in twice if you had two ballots.
I don't think that's right, Bob.
Right. So I didn't come in here without researching this, so that's why I'm reading the questions, just to make you aware of this.
Yeah, but the notion that we manipulated the schedule to.
That's not true.
To guarantee a turnout.
Jim, you know me, come on.
Talking to a lot of people in town and a lot of people are concerned, so I thought I would come down and present.
I appreciate that.
I'm glad you got that off your chest.
And the other thing is that there's some people who are already predisposed with their decisions. They sort of tipped their hand at a couple of those meetings, so.
Actually, I don't think there's five of us, only four are here today. I don't think any four of us are predisposed to what we're thinking about doing. We've been working really hard and long debating about not only what the extent of an override might be, what it's going to encompass, the composition of who pays and how much and what. So there's not a lot of predisposition here, and that's why we're taking our time to do it correctly.
Bringing out more information, and that'll happen when August, sometime August.
Is it August 9th?
Some of it'll happen tonight.
So I just wanted to stand up and tell you that.
Thank you.
This is not under the radar. There are a number of people that are discussing this. I've been reaching out and networking with people.
Well, that's also part of why we wanted to put out as much information as we had, so everybody, you know, could have that time to kind of go through it all.
The library thing is an example of why we need to get more information out, because I believe that project has really encumbered the budget in the town. I think it was the way the elections were set up, it just left a bad taste in a lot of people's mouths. The turnout was extremely low. They were talking about the percentage of people who were for it. When you actually looked at the total voting rolls and who voted and the numbers of people voted, it was a very small percentage.
Right.
So I'm trying to avoid that this time around. We need to have as many people involved as we can.
You raise a great point, and I can't tell you how many people come and if they have a complaint about the library will be, why didn't this board do more, or why didn't the library trustees do more? And the answer is, the vote's before the town. The vote's going to determine the outcome. It's up to some extent, and I love the fact that we're networking, and one of the reasons we're doing these listening sessions is to get as much grassroots awareness and have people show up and say, hey, what's this mean? What's that date? How do I learn more? I don't want another election where 7% determine the outcome for the entire town. I really like
that's
a healthy.
Exactly what happened. The scope of that library project seemed to expand as on a weekly basis, and we don't want that to happen again.
We're aware.
So I'll leave that.
Thank you for your comments.
I agree with almost everything you said about the library process, but just to clarify one thing. The money being spent in the library in no way impacts the budget of the town. It does not encumber the town's budget. It might encumber your wallet, but it was done as an exclusion, so it has no impact on the rest of the operations of the town.
Well, I just want to make a comment. The YES group, they were behind the library project. They're behind. Were there signs that said YES for the Reading Library?
That was probably a different group.
It's not the same group. They may be crossover people, I'm sure, but it's not like a set group that's in town.
Well, this group is putting out a lot of misinformation. They're going to PTO meetings, putting out misinformation. They're using a bunch of scare tactics about this 2.5 thing. I'd looked at your slide, one of the meetings, one of the tabs showed a list of all the towns who recently had overrides and the frequency of overrides.
Mm-hmm.
There's a direct correlation between the activity of the YES group and the frequency of overrides in these towns. So what we have is an activist group here that's trying to push through on a similar process that was used in the library situation. So those are concerns that need to be looked at.
Oh, keep in mind, we can't control what residents do with their own time and organizing in their own ways.
But I want to make that known.
And we're also not in the market of bullying around the group to tell them what they should and should not be doing as well. I mean, it is true that I'm sure there's groups out there that are advocating for it. If you're very concerned, you could have a group that could advocate against it.
I understand.
You know, it's
I'm just talking about what we're facing here. Pressure is going to be intense on you. And it's coming basically from a group who's going to PTO meetings, making presentations, scaring parents, the usual tactics.
There's five people in the town of Reading that can determine whether or not there's going to be an override. And it's four of us sitting here.
We can determine the question. We're not going to determine
the vote, but whether there will be one.
You also have a conflict of interest on the finance committee. The person who was the head of the YES group has been on the finance committee. And now
I believe he resigned that position before he got on.
He did resign that position.
That was a condition of his being appointed.
Is it? I don't need to say anymore. So he was advocating to spend money, so he's on the finance.
I can appreciate that you're concerned about it, but you know, rest assured.
He needs to resign from the finance.
Well, hold on, sir. Just rest assured that you know we're putting out this information so everybody can make informed decisions.
Right.
We can't control people and what they do.
Right.
What we can control is make sure that everybody does have all the pertinent information. They can then decide for themselves what they want to do with it. Then they can decide for themselves if we actually put that forward. What they're going to do as far as the vote goes. I'm just going to end it with that because we do have other people that want to make public comment.
We just don't want to get rolled like we did on the line.
Yes, Mr. Brown.
Bill Brown, Precinct 8. I will assure the gentleman if there's any manipulation going on, I'd be the first one down here to tell you that. And over the history of that I've been involved in town meeting, the biggest turnout we've ever had at a town election is about 15%. And even precinct 8 this year, 50. We had 5 write-ins. So that tells you what the climate of this town is, unfortunately. And if he wants to start a new group, I'll work with him.
There you go. You got two members right
That's
there.
Some signs, right? Huh? You have some signs.
No, I mean, all my signs are put on.
We can't be a no group because we have to come up with something more positive.
Is there any other public comment?
We want to be creative, not negative.
I like that attitude.
Thanks, Jim. Appreciate
not
it.
Yet. Not yet.
All right, seeing none. Yes, Lisa.
Hi, Lisa Egan, 8 Oak Ridge Road in Reading. I just wanted to say thanks to the selectmen and the town manager and everyone for having the charrette. I'm sorry I wasn't able to attend, but I got great feedback on it. And I was so happy that the chamber went out and tried to bring a lot of business members and developers and people in the community, both chamber members and not chamber members, together to really advocate for the business climate. So I'm glad you were pleased with the turnout. We were as well. I'm thrilled that you're thinking about doing another session, perhaps just with the developers or perhaps a larger group with all business community members invited. But be sure a lot of the developers are present because I do think it's really important that it makes sense for them, all the time and effort, and it's a collaborative effort. And I appreciate just your opening the lines of communication with the business community. I also wanted to mention that I do think it's really important that the overlay district and the smart growth district be as inclusive as possible. I think sometimes there's a perception that if it's continued further down Washington Street or down through more of the residential neighborhoods, that with that zoning opportunity being present, that bulldozers are going to pull into town and things are going to change dramatically. And I know that that's not the case. I just want to see business owners and property owners have more opportunity. As you know, living downtown and increased foot traffic really does help all of everyone in town, but also, you know, people who have downtown businesses. And I also know that there's concerns about parking, but someone who lives in town and also parks downtown, my office is on Pleasant Street, I think it's short-sighted to say we shouldn't have a wider smart growth district because of the parking issue. I think that sort of putting the chicken before the egg, I think that we do have a lot of paved area in town and there's some creative solutions. I know we probably can't put forth a $45 million parking garage, but with all the smart talent and you know, studies and people who can look at the problem, I'm sure we can find a great solution. I know firsthand of two business owners on Main Street who are actively looking at other properties outside of Reading because they are not able to provide the mixed use with residential on top. And I don't want to see those businesses leave town. I would like more opportunities to exist for people to improve their infrastructure.
Now, Lisa, are those businesses outside of our smart growth currently
right now?
No, they're
within. They're within, which is great.
I think we do allow that mixed use within that smart growth, correct? Right?
Yeah. Well, I think
you may want to reach back out to them.
I think they're within the perimeter of where you're planning on expanding it on Main Street, but they're not in the smart. They're just a block or two down.
Yes, John.
Lisa, I want to thank you as well. It's clear the volunteers on CPDC and the town did an immense amount of work to get us to that moment, and just getting consensus in the room was an achievement by itself. But I found the most illuminating portion, I think you might have heard it earlier, when some of the professional developers stood up and, without a room full of people to hear their words, said, there's three parts of this that you don't have right yet. And what are they? My question is, what are they?
Mm-hmm.
And I realized very quickly that while the initial plan sounds great on paper, they were able to see, because they work in the industry, they had some knee-jerk reactions. One of them was parking, for example. One of the comments I got was, you don't have enough parking. Well, what do you mean? We have asphalt everywhere. No, you don't understand. You don't have enough parking. And it's that kind of realization that the lens we're looking through is just very different. I'm not a developer. I'm just an ordinary citizen, best of intentions. But somebody who lives in that space, works in that industry, can come in and give you three or four tips that change the whole dynamic. So that, to me, that last half hour conversation was the cherry on the cake. The early part of the evening was great, but just realizing that we could make three or four more changes and maybe really rev it up was just so powerful. So thank you for, it's not only the quantity of attendees, but the quality of them made a big difference.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it was great that everyone came together, and I'm glad to know there's plans to further the discussion because I think it really, people feel valued and when they're listened to and they have great feedback and we're not just having decisions come down. It's really a lot of engagement, which I'm happy about. I also, to Erin's point earlier, I know that I did exchange emails with the Downtown Retailers Group as well as Bob and Leslie Leahy about the signage on Main Street and utilizing that space. And if there's an issue with there being something with the Historic Committee, I would be happy on behalf of just chamber businesses and businesses in town to sit with them to explain what we might want to do there. Where once we all talked about it via email in a day or two, I had already had Andy Chico offer to make the signs for free and a designer who was going to start mocking it up. And I appreciate that the laws exist that we can't do it right now. But if it's a matter of maybe speaking with the Historical Commission, where it's very valuable, very visible town real estate, the chamber would take responsibility for getting the signs made. We would, you know, work with Caitlin in the town manager's office to make sure we put the signs up and down as other people who have the slots are taken. But I thought it was a great idea on Leslie Leahy's behalf to say, let's use that prime real estate to remind people to shop local because you really can't say it enough. And, you know, with all the Amazon boxes and everyone's trash, myself included, it's a great way to remind people to eat, play, work, live, whatever, in the town. So we'd be very interested in helping move that forward when the time was right, whether I could sit with the Historical Commission and talk about, you know, our intentions there. It's really to utilize the space on our own time and expense.
The signs you speak of are the ones by Walgreens, the former Walgreens? Is that the ones you're talking about?
Yeah, well, the ones right there on the
out
common
on the
where there's three slots.
They have like the band and football and...
Well, there's actually a whole schedule. No, no,
thinking
they're
of the
right
wrong
there
sign.
On the common. There's
open the window and look out.
I'll drive by later tonight.
And, you know, we do have one for Shop the Block, for example, which is great, and we have one for the tree lighting. Or if there's a play at the high school, one will go up. And those signs are always spoken for. Like, you know, like 4 o'clock on Friday, yours comes down. If you don't pick it up, out it goes. But it's great visible space. So we would be utilizing those if they aren't previously spoken for. Like, you know, a sort of a placeholder, but to remind people to shop local in Reading.
Okay. Bob, would it be worth it to ask the historical commission to come in, we could chat whether it's within the
I suppose I should talk to them first.
Just to see if it's a possibility to revisit the policy or what the extent of the policies are.
I mean, I know there's a lot going on, so it's not a top burning priority, but it is, I think it would be great to remind people in that visible space just to, you know, remember the local economy that they support by shopping
yep.
here.
Good. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further comments?
Yes,
okay, seeing none.
I got a couple.
Bob? Oh, good.
Thanks. On page 21 of your packet tonight, you recall about a month ago in the schools there were some lead identified and some testing.
Yep.
And that's been largely remediated, will be when schools open. Killam was the highest quantity. We decided to test all the public buildings after the schools were done, senior center and the whole nine yards, nothing. Literally nothing at all in all in any of the town buildings, which was a little surprise. So I just wanted to make sure you were aware of that. That's an email in your packet from last Thursday when we learned that. And then lastly, on pages 4 and 5, I've updated, I described it in a memo, but I updated the working groups to include cable negotiations specifically as an objective. I think that's really important. There's another community not far from us, not contiguous, but not far, that's running into some issues getting legal help because it's a hot topic.
Yeah.
So I realize we better ramp it up even though it's
good
two
catch.
And a half years away.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's all.
All right. Next on the agenda then is approved town manager's contract.
That's me. So up on the screen, I have a survey that was done back in January of 2016 by HR and myself to determine what other town managers make in our peer communities. And it averages out to 172.45. And we compared it to where our town manager was paid, and he's about 13% behind. So this was information that was requested by the board to try and start the discussion of the contract for Bob. And so in order to get to the fiscal 17 numbers, we assumed a 2.5% increase of those numbers. And then I had worked with the town council, the administrative services director, John Halsey, and Bob to get all the details together for his contract. Bob, being very fair, didn't want to accept an increase higher than that was given to the non-union staff. And, you know, John Halsey was very adamant that he wanted to try to make some progress towards getting him a little bit further up so he wasn't so behind the others. And so as a compromise, they agreed to change his hours from 37.5 to 40 to, you know, to do it that way, to give him a little bit of a bump that way. He works well in excess of 40 hours
every
week.
It's about half time.
It's
just
like
today.
It's probably 2 days.
It's
work.
A 7 day
by
work
Wednesday,
week for him.
Certainly.
I mean, I get emails from him Saturday, Sunday. I mean, so he works well in excess
yeah.
of that, but that would be just compensating him for 2.5 more hours
right.
each week. And so down below here, you'll see that we added that in there. We would be starting that August 1st because his contract isn't in place. So this is done at the old rate and then at the new rate. And then another addition to the contract was the ability to buy back a week of vacation or sell back a week of vacation if the appropriate funds were there.
Yep.
And so we added that in to get him to a figure that's about 4 or 5%, about 5% below what the average is. And that's where we drew the number. This number here is what you're going to see in the contract, and that's kind of essentially what he gets in total if he actually opts for selling that week of vacation. The other changes that were made to the contract had to do with the notice that needs to be given regarding the termination of the contract, whether it be on the town manager's side or on your side. So if you wanted to terminate or not renew his contract in the prior agreement with 60 days notice, in this agreement, it's now 6 months.
Right.
And so the same for him. If you wanted to terminate employment, he would have to give you 6 months notice. So it's like it seems like the notice has changed from 6 months all across the board because it's kind of the time frame it would probably take you to replace him. So that was a change that was made. That's the only like you know, his increase is basically mirroring what we have for the non-union staff, which is a step and a 2% COLA, and then obviously the change from 37 and a half hours to 40, and the ability to buy back or sell back a week of vacation if he decides not to use it. So that's the total compensation package. He doesn't get anything in addition to that. No car stipend, none of that. Although we did see that some communities have
Lamborghini.
Like, yeah. So he is still trailing by 5%, even with all that. And so I feel the number is fair, but that's all Bob would be willing to go with. So,
okay.
So that's where we landed. So it's really up to discussion for all of you. Is that where you want to land, and do you want us to work this a little bit further, or are you okay with it? So.
A couple of clarifying questions.
Sure.
Is this the original language with a few edits, or did you start with a blank sheet?
It was the original language with some edits, and it was a lot of back and forth between
okay.
town council and some, you know, some changes
okay.
changes to the language based on, you know, what we wanted to add.
Secondly, Bob, I can't remember, but the language in either the charter or maybe one of the bylaws requires the Board of Selectmen to appoint a new town manager a year, and I don't know if it's a year after notice or a year after exit. Do you recall? It was 6 months when the charter got rewritten and we set it back.
Do you remember that, Bill?
I don't remember.
What's that, Bill?
Some period of time where a new town manager, you could have an interim.
But you're obligated
but there's
to.
There's probably some time limit on how long you can have an interim. I don't remember that.
I think it's 1 year, but my question is, does it get triggered by the notice or
the
get triggered by the departure?
Departure.
Okay, so actually this is added. And lastly, the expenses is in my space, we always want expenses paid out immediately so there's no liability, everything's trued up. Do you really want to do it quarterly, or would you rather
do
it
change that?
To
it used to be quarterly, and now it's just whatever non-union
like
do, which
okay.
is done quickly.
Right.
I like that.
Those are my questions.
Yep. Move the Board of Selectmen approve the employment agreement between the Town of Reading and Robert LaLasher for services as town manager effective August 1, 2016 to July 31st, 2018.
Second.
I'd just like to make a brief comment.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank Bob for his service and just state that I'm extremely grateful to be able to vote on this motion and have Bob with us for two more years.
Thank you.
Here. I just wanted to emphasize as well, too, Sharon touched on it very quickly, but as probably a lot of people that work inside this building know, Bob does work a lot more in excess than 40 hours. So I think this is very much a good contract for us as a town. The next 2 years, because we really have somebody who knows what they're doing running the ship here. So that's all I have to say. Any further?
I'll let it come.
Yeah,
yeah.
If you don't mind. I'd like to thank the board. I'd like to especially thank Dan and John, who came in last winter and strong-armed me.
literally.
No, literally. Yeah, I was afraid for a little while. I almost called the chief. I fully respect the board as my appointee and Sharon's appointee that. They wanted to show the community that paying average is not something to be proud of, but it's something we can afford to do. And I think through back and forth discussion, they became aware that paying average is just not reasonable. You know, the amount of money to get me to 0% to average is not a lot, but it's not right when other people in our employment are not there.
Right.
You know, and I do appreciate the fact that the board was willing to step back because in a way, by doing that, you're acknowledging what we've done for years, which is not to pay our employees fairly, which is considered average. And that's fine, I have no problem with that. I also wanted to point out on page 13 of your packet tonight, I had run this by just Chairman Halsey. You know, every year you're obliged to do a performance evaluation. Last year, you did a very thorough one. I had given the board last year the superintendent's form, which is a state form, is very onerous. I offer this. John loved it when he saw it. This is what we do for all of our employees in the town
okay.
of Reading, on the town side. I don't see why you wouldn't subject me to the exact same form and format.
I think we need to do that by the 30th of September.
And you're obliged to do that by the end of September.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm not sure what the penalty is if you don't.
we dock our pay one
yeah.
week.
Yeah, all right.
Well, this is
so thank
work
you.
Here for us
yeah.
as well.
You're welcome.
I just also I wanted to echo comments of my colleagues here, but also to take the opportunity to point out that, you know, from the top, we're paying our town manager below average, and it's not just the town manager; it's a lot of hardworking people who provide services as this town. So for a second, I don't want people to think because we're paying people below average that they're getting below average service. I would argue that we're getting above average service, and that we really, you know, as we think hard about what our budgetary future, a lot of when we decide, you know, are we going to dig into our pockets for a little bit more, you know, 70-80% of what we pay in our taxes goes to the salaries of people from Bob and Sharon on down. So I just want to kind of put that out there, that's where your tax dollars go, and we're getting A plus service for probably, you know, B compensation. So Bob, thank you. I'm happy to vote for this
thank
as
you.
Well.
John?
For those watching on TV, it must seem that this is a math problem. You take the averages of the town, you strike the mean, you determine where you lie, and you decide if that's where you want to be or not. That measures really the economics problem, but what it doesn't do is tell you the value and the ethic, the work ethic and the work quality. And it's really difficult to size that, but I can tell you, working closely with Bob now for multiple years, we have, in my opinion, a consummate professional that thinks first of the town before he thinks of himself. And you've seen it here tonight, somebody who's willing to deny themselves something that they might otherwise argue for because they recognize circumstances don't permit it. I don't think you can find that quality very often, particularly in the next generation of leadership. I see it often in folks that have been in industry for a while, but you don't see it much in the young folks. And we're really blessed, and I mean the word blessed, to have town leadership, the caliber and the ethics of Bob. And there's no way to capture that in a financial figure, but it's worth its weight in gold. Thank you.
Is everybody for a vote? All those in favor? Those against? 4-0. All right, moving on to Birch Road utility easements. Bob?
Thanks. Again, in your packet tonight on page, I think it's 17. Yeah, 17. There's a memo from town engineer Ryan Percival. This is, if you will, a standard practice. We're just extending our water, sewer, and drainage systems out to these parcels. So in your motion, did you put drainage in the motion, Paula? I don't remember looking.
I didn't change that motion.
Okay, if there's not the word drainage in there, it should be added. Ryan caught that yesterday, I think. I don't know, is there anyone here from Birch? No, I don't see it.
Do not have drainage in the motion.
It should be water, sewer, and drainage.
Drainage
so if we just need this in order to maintain our infrastructure, you know, to this property.
So it's not complicated.
Water, comma, sewer,
and
easement.
Yeah.
Water and sewer.
Drainage.
Yep.
Right.
And drainage.
Got it.
Drainage.
Time for that?
We're just extending this again. Well, I'm sorry, it's that part. We're extending this just for the, where's that little slide you just had up?
Oh, for the picture? Yeah. Whoops.
So here's Birch Road. Here's the easement right in here, the shaded area.
Yeah.
I assume that comes through. Yeah, it's a little light. It's all this area.
This is a private road?
Yeah.
Okay.
Without this easement, the town is legally not allowed to maintain the water, sewer, drainage system.
So housekeeping.
Yeah.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to approve the plan of land entitled Easement Plan of Land located in Reading, Massachusetts, Middlesex County, Southern District, prepared for Sage Development, scale 1 inch, 20 feet, date May 1, 2016, prepared by Sullivan Engineering Group, LLC, P.O. Box 204, Woburn, Mass., to be recorded at the Middlesex South Registry of Deeds with a grant of a water and sewer and drainage easement to the town of Reading. Said easement and plan are required in order for the commencement of a Reading Department of Public Utilities, Public Works utility project.
Second.
Further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 4-0.
Thank you. Next up on your agenda, as I explained in a memo over the weekend, was Hunt and Lee Streets.
Yep.
Town Council drew up abandoning an easement for the length of the whole street. the engineers realized they didn't really want to do that. It was too much, so back to the drawing board, and you'll see that in front of you again at a future
meeting.
Okay,
so
okay.
We're passing.
What are the circumstances by which you abandon? Did you have a replacement in place already?
I'm not even sure, honestly, in this case, whether there was a different, an alternative one built,
okay,
or it was just never needed.
Okay.
It's been done before.
Yeah.
It's an undo.
It is.
All right, seeing how we're past the hour,
mm-hmm,
right, the hearing.
Let's see.
Well, that's
okay.
Not going to work.
Town of Reading. To the inhabitants of the Town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading will hold a public hearing on July 26, 2016 at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., on a driveway waiver for 43 Track Road. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on the 26th of July to townmanager@ci.reading.mads.us by order of Robert Lasher, Town Manager.
If I could just start, I know we have a presentation on page 19. Just before the meeting tonight, the board got an email from one of the abutters. That's the only abutter we've heard from, and just let me read it.
Mm-hmm.
Ruth Silva, 45 Track Road, called to comment on tonight's hearing for the waiver of 43 Track Road. Her and her husband gave no objection to the waiver for the driveway and are actually looking forward to seeing the project done.
Duly noted.
Exactly.
Sure.
Whoops. So, just as background, before this, we see the presentation. We reviewed this on our PTTF. I don't know if that was enough T's. Staff had no objections. It made a great deal of sense. It's a low traffic area, and this is one of those things that was just too logical not to give those.
All right.
There's no objection at all, though.
And I'll be very brief because it does make a lot of sense. This is a distressed property on Track Road.
If you don't mind just introducing yourself.
My name is Bob Griffin. I'm with Griffin Engineering. In Beverly, the owner of the property, Mr. Panzero, is in the back of the room. And Mr. Panzero is is an experienced developer and actually has won some awards for historical renovation projects in the North Shore. This is not a historical renovation project, but simply there's a very distressed property here, which is the shaded gray here at number 43 Track Road. He's proposing to raise that structure and replace it with a two-story colonial-style single-family house.
Mm-hmm.
This lot is very undersized as compared to the zoning district. It has about 6,000 square feet of land where 15,000 is required. But we can make a conforming structure work as shown here. The current structure is not conforming, and you can see it's very close to the lot line here. Miss Milton's property that we just heard from is this property to the bottom of the page here. And basically this is located where you come down Torrey Street, you come around here, and then you turn to Track Road to sort of make the loop around this particular area. We're simply requesting to reduce the setback from the intersection here to 30 feet, where 50 feet is normally required. I think you can see that it really is not going to have any significant effect on traffic flow. Certainly your PTTF people felt the same way. I'll show you a couple of quick pictures of the property here just so you get a little flavor if you haven't driven by. But you can see it's really a crummy piece of property. The existing driveway is right here. We're moving it about 5 to 10 feet closer to the intersection than the current driveway. I'd be happy to address any questions.
So where's the current box?
So here's it here, here it is there. The current driveway is right next to this telephone pole here, which is very close to the lot line. We're going to pull it basically close to the end of the granite curbing here. We'll have to remove about 4 or 5 feet of granite curbing to make this work. This is looking towards that intersection, so this edge goes pretty close to the blue state when we're done.
And how far are you?
Yes, we are.
How far are you moving it over? About 5 feet from its current position?
No, I think on this edge it's going to be about 10 feet.
Okay.
The driveway gets a little bit wider. It's a total width of about 22 feet. But if you can see that granite, where the granite curving ends there, the near edge of the driveway will be about 4 feet into that granite, that line of granite curving. So we're going to have to remove about 4 feet of granite curving as part of the driveway construction project.
Is this going into a garage?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is granite curving on both sides of the road at that point? On the other side of, I guess it's Harvest,
yes, it is.
Or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Any questions?
Move to close the hearing on the driveway waiver for 43 Track Road.
Second.
Comments? All those in favor? 4-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the driveway for 43 Track Road with a 30-foot offset.
Second.
Comments? All those in favor? 4-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good night.
All right. Preview of the September 12th special town meeting warrant.
I apologize, I can't bring this up on the computer because our website's down, but I'll go over quickly. On page 20 of your packet, a September special town meeting, should the board call for one, would have 8 articles. The first 3 are mandated by charter. Reports, instructional motions, and then a capital plan. The timing is actually good because the fire chief has a request to increase the ambulance funding for a capital project this year. It was approved, ready for July 1st. He went out and got bids, and believe it or not, he's $1,500 short out of $275,000 purchase.
Not bad.
So he's close, but he needs the other $1,500. He can't have the ambulance. In his process, he's also going to go to FinCom. I think it's the August 31st now at this point. There's an additional piece of safety equipment that goes with the ambulance that he believes is worth doing for another 24 or so thousand.
So that's more than just an amendment to the capital plan.
So that's different. That's
an appropriation as well.
And that will be in addition to the capital plan, and the FinCom reserves will be the way to pay for it until November.
Oh, I get it.
Because
okay.
Just so you're aware, in September, the town does not have free cash it can use.
Right.
It could use the stabilization fund or where it's a relatively small amount of money, the FinCom reserve fund.
Right.
So that's the background. So Article 3 capital is somewhat handy. We've discussed in the past, and can do that tonight in some detail. I'll read some of the senior tax policy articles. Increase the senior exemption from $750 to $1,000. Accept the optional cost of living increase for seniors and surviving spouses. And lower the interest rate on tax deferrals. This board, in brevity and certainly with the chair, has discussed these three should be brought forward to a town meeting regardless of anything else. That, 5 or 6 years ago, we did one of these and brought it up from 500 to 750. It's a question of constantly surveying your peers and keeping up with your peers at the very least. Maybe this is something we should have proactively just gone to 1,000 instead of 500.
Could you describe the exemption, what it means?
Is there about 20 people that qualify?
On average, not more than 25, because the income and asset limits are so small. By adopting the COLA exemption, it'll allow us to adjust those by whatever COLA figure the state releases to us each and every year, hopefully increasing the recipient pool.
So you're talking about this exemption on state taxes, state tax returns?
No,
property. Statutory elder exemption and your surviving spouse exemption.
What is the threshold, Victor? Who's the
single person is? For a single person, their income must be less than $20,000 and less than $30,000 if married. That knocks mostly everybody out of the box right there.
Okay.
And assets can't exceed $40,000 if single or $55,000 if married.
How are these asset assessments done? Is it done by the state or?
No, by you declare to us what your assets are. We look at your bank statements, your financial records, CDs, IRAs, stocks, bonds. Exclusive of the house.
But it's self-disclosure.
Yes. Under the pains and penalties of
does it count, Victor, are those assets IRAs and 401ks included in that?
Yes.
So,
including retirement assets.
Yes.
If you're a single person, 65 or older, with a $25,000 pension and scrimped and saved to have a $50,000 IRA, you cannot qualify.
I don't think anyone's debating the thresholds, but it's more the review and enforcement, and that would be done by what organ? You're going
to? You're looking at him.
That's pains and penalties right over there.
That's right. he's pains.
To deal with.
Sharon is penalties. and just to be clear, this 750 to 1,000 change is lost tax revenue to the town. It is not recovered. It comes out of the overlay account.
So. I know later on we're going to discuss, a more robust senior assistance for tax. So it's conceivable if we did something like that, that they might also qualify for one, two, or three of these other things. So
absolutely.
Are all of our sort of, is all of our assistance going to be cumulative, or are we going to cap it at a certain point? And, you know, let's say if we do the more robust version of it, that kind of, you know, that's everything, or
these are independent.
Robust version is revenue neutral to the town.
But if you're qualifying for let's say the 1,000,
yes,
can you also qualify for the maximum under this new program?
Yes,
I think you can.
Yes,
so you can be the max plus 1,000.
No, because in some of the options you'll see that are prevented, we
okay.
can set certain caps on it,
okay.
like the max.
That was my
amount
question.
Would
okay.
be
okay. Yeah. Okay.
Such
sure.
and such a
so
percent.
You take
of
a higher amount.
Right.
Yeah.
In other words, you can't. Right. You can't.
Take
I mean, you can double dip as long as you. As long as when your cumulative benefit is not over a certain amount. Okay, that was my question.
The other article there that's interesting is the interest rate deferral. Yeah, it's certainly not a well-known thing that seniors, again, with certain qualifications, can remain in their home and defer interest, defer property taxes at a certain interest rate. This will actually lower that interest rate, I believe, to 4%.
We can choose
about.
Whatever
okay.
we
I think
want,
we're talking
but
about
we've
four.
Done 4% in Wakefield.
Mm-hmm.
And from discussions I've had with some of the seniors in the community, you know, it is a caution that if you die while you're in your house, your estate pays as if it were the higher number all along, and then they've all said, that's not my problem. but it allows a senior, again, not to pay any property tax while they're staying in the house, and defer. And then
right.
if they move out, you know, move to another residence, then it's due. At 4%.
But if they should pass, it goes back to
that
the statutory
to
limit.
Statutory. No.
Did we confirm that? Because I know there was
yeah.
some
yeah, we did.
Miscommunication on that matter. Okay.
Yep.
So that's a purely local decision. It does not require any act of the legislature. To,
no, it requires just an act of town meeting.
Yep.
Yeah, these three are clearly outlined in previously released information guideline releases from the Department of Revenue.
Article 7, which will be the meat of the discussion for tonight, and it'll go through August 9th, is a home rule petition. I'm not even going to say anything other than you're going to hear about that. That is a requirement that we go to town meeting and get their authorization on every detail and specific wording of that home rule petition. Article 8 is loosely described as a Prop 2.5 override ballot question. The language, and I'm going to get into this, and it might answer this fellow's questions from earlier. I'll get into a timeline. The exact language of a question is not needed and not anticipated to go to this town meeting, and I'll get into that. Town meeting has no authority on a Prop 2.5 override. I've heard from a number of town meeting members who are not happy that they're being asked to even have an opinion on this through a town meeting.
Right.
They don't have to. I've also heard from a couple of members in, I think it might have been Bill's precinct, that ran for town meeting with the thought that they could decide a Prop 2.5 override. So there's a little bit of misinformation
besides.
And clearly at the beginning we'll have to explain. Town Council is going to word the language of this question basically to be for the board to hear advice from town meeting. So
this is going to be a motion with no vote.
Yes.
Is that allowed under Robert's rules?
It is. We discussed whether it should belong under Article 2. And it's
we
fine.
We don't operate under Robert's rules.
Town meeting time. I amended my statement. Yeah.
I'll look it up when I go home.
Yeah.
So it would be under the report section or under instructions?
No. We discussed that and decided it really belonged as a standalone article
right,
because
okay.
you want to have a discussion and reports typically don't. So that's the outline. And let me get into the memo I'm sending to the school committee tomorrow night because there's some misunderstandings. I think I want to get to, I just reviewed the warrant. Just for everyone's benefit, August 9th, the Selectmen will continue a discussion. They'll start tonight on tax policy, and we'll possibly begin a discussion on the town FY18 budget. It'll either be the 9th or the 16th, depending on how far you get. August 16th, the school committee is going to join you in a posted meeting. We're rearranging the agenda a little, and they want to have a discussion with you about how much they want and why, and then we'll have a chance to, you know, describe that in detail. So again, that's August 16th. August 31st and September 1st, back-to-back nights, are first a FinCom meeting to preview what goes on the next night, and then the next night is the advertised at the high school auditorium, the Community Financial Forum. Now, the board has some choices here, and I, in the memo, couldn't speak to, you know, what you wanted. We haven't discussed it. You could have a number decided in time for August 31st, and a path, an exact path, and whether or not it's exact language, you know what it's going to say. So it could either be broad language about for the operating of the towns or the schools, or it could be specific, like mosquito spraying, like it was 13 yeah. years ago. And then you can have a dollar figure. You don't have to have it these nights, so it's a policy question. You do have to have a final figure, and you need to vote the night of town meeting, September 12th, because that is when the actual language must be put in front of you, and you must cast a vote in order to call for a special election on October 18th.
Figure plus the number and type of question.
Right. So if you want to direct any of the first year's money at specific things, it has to be in the exact language. So your hard deadline is September 12th. Again, it's a policy question as to whether you want to present to that town meeting what that is. You don't have to. You could. Probably should.
Yeah.
And then there's also some question about whether September 1st or August 31st you want to present an answer, or do you want to present some thoughts and do some more listening? And there's no easy answer to that question. But the school committee was a little confused last night. They believed that at your meeting on August 16th that the exact language of a ballot question had to be finalized, because they thought you were calling an election that night. So that's the purpose of this memo. So I just wanted to lay out to you.
I think there was some confusing language in one of the previous calendars to that okay. regard. We talked about that.
Did you send that memo yet?
No, it's going tomorrow for them for tomorrow night. I've sent it to John.
Very good. You're comfortable to send a copy?
Yeah.
To the board?
Sure.
Thank you.
Is there any reason why we can't be ready by September 1st
no.
to kind of have what we're going to be?
You really should.
I mean, you know, the election is, if it's called, will be October 18th.
Yeah.
So if we wait till, you know, town meeting to kind of take that vote, yeah, that's 5 weeks. Which is a pretty constrained period of time. I mean, we've been talking about this. I think we kind of know, we don't know what we want to do, but I think we know sort of the, you know, the general bracketing of what we want to do.
Right.
I would counsel us to kind of try to do it as soon as we can to allow more 16th. Time for it to percolate into the community, neighborhood meetings, discussions, groups, whatever.
I agree.
You know, I think people are looking for us to do that.
Yeah, let me share some of the rest of the memo, because it's going to help kind of frame the discussion. Make this a little smaller. Well, that's good enough. In a nutshell, and this is a real simplification, but it works pretty well, our financial situation can be summed up by three variables: state aid, health insurance, and other revenues that aren't state aid. Other revenues that aren't state aid are this blue line. Everything starts at 1.0 in FY17 where we are, and it grows.
Just normal.
So it's going to grow to 30% by FY25, 1.3. State aid is lagging. The last few years it's run at about a 0.7 or 1.2 rate of increase annually. This is 1.2% increase. Right now there's no gap between the rest of revenues and state aid as a given. 8 years from now, this is almost a $3 million gap. If state aid had grown at the rate of all the other revenues, it would have produced $3 million a year more, which is kind of hard to digest.
I'm sorry, say that one more time. If
this gap is a couple million dollars, not quite three. So if state aid were growing at the 3.25,
okay,
3.5 run rate over 8 years,
it'd be $3 million ahead.
It'd be $3 million ahead. If health insurance were only growing at your revenue run rate, you'd be $6 million ahead.
That's unbelievable.
This $9 million delta in round numbers is the problem. All other revenues cover all other costs very well. Not perfectly, but pretty well. So, you know, just like anything, you can always blame something. But this really, these really stand out. And we've always anecdotally talked about the unpredictability of health insurance and a couple of other things. But in the last 3 years, so far we've done well, knock on wood. We're not going to be exempt from what's going on in the country, which is not. And then state aid was very good maybe 6, 7, 8 years ago, but it's definitely fallen off a cliff since then. So if you look at this picture, wherever you start, it doesn't matter. $100 million, $150 million budget, doesn't matter where you start, there's a gap.
Right, you'll always have a gap.
So you're trying to put a lump sum of money called an override to fix this problem. It's not going to.
Right.
What you need is something like Prop 4 or 3.5, not Prop 2.5. You need something that escalates annually. You're not going to get that. State tax policy allows you to ask for a dollar figure only. So conceptually, if you want to look at that $9 million gap, you need to fund, and again, this is only on paper, you need to fund an override. You just draw a line straight across.
Midpoint.
Midpoint. In the early years, you don't need it. You're going to need it later on.
You bank it.
When you do that, you know, you save some portion here, you bank it, and you use it out here, and everything looks nice and tidy. At the end of that, you've got a $9 million hole in your budget.
Right.
So effectively, you're building a reliance on free cash that you've saved in the early years. That, in a nutshell, is the really difficult part about the math behind an override.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling this to the school committee because they were a little concerned that the selectmen weren't discussing specific lines in the budget yet. And I said, we're looking at policy stuff. You know, we're looking at tax policy and we're looking at this issue, and that. If you look right here, an override has to do two or three things. First, fix the structural deficit, which we all agree is about $3 million, about $2 million for them, about $1 million on the town side. Two is optional. Restore prior budget cuts and add new services. That's clearly optional. It seems logical if you're going to bother to have an override, you'd want to do some of that. And then the third one, and the important one that's invisible, is filling that gap I just described somehow. So that's the challenge.
That's the gap if you do absolutely nothing. That's a gap if you just keep everything the same way. So you're.
How long do you want an override to last?
Right.
That's the answer to that question, and it's again.
Let's rephrase that for those that are going to jump that if override is an increase forever. Yes, we know that. But you're talking about how long will the override cover the deficit?
Yeah, what I'm saying is if you pick a number, did a $5 million override,
right,
and you spent all $5 million in the first year.
Right.
You'd have the same problem. There's a mismatch of cost and revenues.
So is that the reason why, one of the telling slides you presented was sort of how Reading compared to other towns around here over the last, I don't know, 15 or so years in terms of how many times they've gone to their voters for an override. I mean, we've gone once in 13 years, yet we saw each of our core towns go at least once, if not twice, over that period of time. Is that because they couldn't manage, you know, so
I better not say that.
Well, I mean, the fact that we didn't ask, is that a sign that we're better managed, that we just sort of stretched the dollar a little bit more? The fact that others asked maybe multiple times is that they, you know, might have gotten it and didn't save enough, or, you know, I think that it's important to kind of understand us in the context of everybody else, and that,
yeah,
you know, it's not like this is a yearly thing. This is a generational thing, and that we've gone, you know, really 13, be 14 years by the time we actually do it. That, you know, how we were able to kind of tell the story about how we were able to manage those expenses, but at a certain point, you get to the end of the cliff, and you either jump or you build more cliff. And,
that's interesting.
Interesting.
So,
I really only should speak for the town side of government and let the schools speak for themselves. But we're very cheap. We don't like spending money.
Well, just we saw that just on the salaries.
Well, but yeah, that's a small example. We just don't, and that's a cultural thing. You know, part of the interview process is, do you like to spend money? And a yes means goodbye. but it really is. It's ingrained in people, and every employee has the opportunity to always suggest improvements of ways to save money, ways to give better service at no cost, and so forth. So it's something that Peter built, you know, many years ago. We've run out of tools. You know, when the override last happened, it was advertised as 8 years. I don't think the math that went into it was nearly as what we're doing now, but it was just, that ought to last about 8 years. And because we've done so much financial work over that time, and the tools are innumerable, you know, performance contracting, debt refinancing, there's just lots of one-trick ponies. We've run out. We're now at the point on the town side where, you know, given the circumstances, we have to either put more money to the budget or cut services or cut the quality of services. And again, I've said this many times, you know, our job is to do whatever the voters want.
Right.
I don't really have an opinion on that, to be honest with you. But, you know, why other towns went more often, I don't know. My guess is they honestly that they didn't work as hard to try to wait. They could have, and they said, you know, let's just ask. And not all of them had them passed. Stoneham has never had one passed.
Right.
So they asked a couple times. They didn't get a yes. Most others have had a yes since we did. But again, not to miss the point that over that period, we have had a high school and a library debt exclusion. Other towns have also done. North Reading has a much bigger high school, middle school debt exclusion. But, you know, it's not like we've completely lived within 2.5, because that's not the case when you count those buildings. So I thought that outline would just be helpful for the board to see.
There's two takeaways from that that I think we've got to stay in the same breath of air when we introduce this. One is, we're not changing the spending discipline on that curve. All you're doing
right.
is asking for a lump sum up front, that if you hold spending discipline, you keep that in reserve. That means in the latter years, where spend is in excess of your revenue, you're working off that, if you will, savings or reserve funds or whatever you call it. Is it free cash at that point?
I would call it that, yeah.
Does it go into a special fund or would
to be discussed?
To be discussed. The second problem is, and you alluded to it, at the end of that period, you're now spending in excess of your revenues by $4 or $5 million?
Well, that's what a financial model would tell you, but I tell you, if what happens, what's shown in that chart, this country will long be bankrupt by health insurance. 8% a year for the next 8 years, it's not gonna happen. No, it can't. Small businesses, R8 is a 15 to a 20 to a small business. Are they gonna survive?
Your point is it's self-limiting, it can't go there.
I think so.
But let's assume for the moment it's
but
not.
But otherwise, yeah, if it happens, you're right.
A different problem, instead of being this, let's say it's this, it's still in excess of revenues at the end of 13 years, 8 years? That means that next year, you've gotta pass an override to make that gap up.
Right.
And then compensate it further, so you.
Right, that's exactly what it is. It's, since you can't pass an override to change the slopes, you have to just.
You can't true up every year, so we true up every year.
Down the road. That's what Prop 2.5 does. Now, I believe, and I'm pretty financially conservative, I believe if a prop question was put forth today, it would not be 2.5. That's too low. When Prop 2.5 happened, health insurance was flat.
True, right.
And towns were still managing, I don't know how, to spend 8, 9, 10% a year.
It was out of control.
With no health insurance increase or very little. So I have to think that, you know, the prop would be different. And thus, now we look back and say it's designed
to
fail and to ask voters what kind of a town do you want to live on a regular basis every 10 years. Or so.
Which is a good conversation to have.
Yeah.
Although Prop 3 wouldn't be bad.
Anything would be slightly better. It just, you know, it doesn't change the slopes, but it changes the time.
Right.
You know, how long you want an override to last for theoretically is a huge variable in this. I think the right answer is say 8 to 10 years. I don't think it's reasonable to say anything longer than that. It's just too expensive.
Well, the other thing, in 8 to 10 years, a lot of our debt exclusion will fall off.
Right.
And, you know, just when this is.
Right.
So it'll be lumping on again, it's just then you can have a conversation about re-upping.
So, not to put the cart too far ahead of the horse.
Which part of the horse?
Yeah, you're the front part of the horse. The schools and public have discussed 2 million structural and 2 million additional, which leads you to conclude the town has 1 million structural and 1 million additional, and that's ballpark, that could be right. That's $6 million. $6 million doesn't cause this, solve this problem. If we really want to spend $6 million in the first year, a $6 million override does not do it. It's more. So that's the discussion that you'll have over the next mm-hmm. couple meetings with the school committee on the 16th.
The six is made up of 4 of catch up and 2 of new. Yeah.
3 and 3.
3 and 3.
Yeah. Yeah, and the 3 structural, I would have to say, is given. I mean, why even have it otherwise? And then the 3 new or additional or catch up, that's debatable. You know, what do you really? How much do you really need? How much do you really want? And then. How much time do you want it to last? And I've only done 8 years. I think that's the minimum. So I just thought that timeline and that exercise might
that
be
8 years, it's really, the number should be 9. No? Or am I reading that wrong?
It's year 8, well, it's year 2025, fiscal 25, which which is eight fiscal years from the one.
Right, but there's a not, but you said there's a $9 million.
Yes, there is a $9 million gap, more or less 8.6 or something. Yeah, I'll send you a copy of this memo.
I just thought that'd be helpful before.
It
Victor.
Sure is. It really tells it. And you might even snap that midline down in there and show the savings component and the spending component.
Yeah, I'll tell you, that'll be an interesting discussion because as a taxpayer, I don't want to hear that you're asking me for $6 million and you're not going to spend six.
It's a tough
conversation.
No, we've got to
spend
six, you're
just going to spend it
all
at once.
Spend it wisely.
Cool. Yeah, so I have to do some work. Oh, yeah, you take that out. I have to really do some thinking to your point of how do you exactly do it. It's easy to describe it theoretically and it makes sense, but do we really do that? No. Are we going to use free cash in a budget in the early years when we're trying to save? Why wouldn't we? We just wouldn't use free cash to balance. But it's much easier to explain a simple model. So there'll be some fine-tuning that'll happen.
By the way, I think you're bargaining at twice the price.
Thank you.
You're not getting a raise.
Coming from a half-time employee, I appreciate it. Victor is our shared assessor with Wakefield.
So, I have been tasked with looking at additional forms of relief for elderly taxpayers, people who might be at most risk, and trying to figure out what might work. Well, in looking around the state, there's not a lot of options beyond what we just discussed out there. Town of Sudbury, 3 years ago, put together a means-tested program. In essence, elder qualifying senior citizens would get an exemption off their property taxes based on income. The higher the income, the less the exemption. Lower the income, higher the exemption. In looking at the Sudbury thing, it reduces real property taxes for certain low to moderate income seniors through a redistribution of the property tax burden within the residential class. What does that mean? Currently, Reading is a single tax rate community. Commercial and residential rates are the same. To consider an exemption like this, we would set aside a certain dollar amount or a percentage amount of the tax levy, but its distribution would be restricted to only the residential class. So the residential class would have a higher tax rate to pay for the exemption for the seniors.
If no other changes were made.
That's right. And I'll get into some slides that show that. I'm trying to keep this simple because, boy, there's lots of twisty roads I could have went down. And
if you have any graphs, Victor,
we'll get to it. We'll get to it. And everything that I have, I know the data wants that you folks are. We'll get it to you, and you can work with that, and then watch me. Oh, did I say that? some of the restrictions that Sudbury has on theirs, and we could keep some of these. We might want to make some modifications. I'm not sure where I'm coming down just yet, but the residents must be owned and occupied, someone 65 or older, whose prior year's income tax would make the person eligible for the circuit breaker income tax credit in accordance with the general laws. So basically, for the senior circuit breaker program, if you have a house under a certain value and your income is doesn't exceed their amounts, you can get up to like $1,030 off of your income taxes.
I just want to stop you there. I think that's a really important point, that this is one of those things where we don't want to cause a lot more work that's not worth the effort. And, you know, to the earlier point, Victor is in the business of, for 20 or 25 taxpayers, assessing, you know, net worth and income. It's such an easy thing to just rely on an already existing state income tax program, and I like that as the gatekeeper, just to throw that out there.
And that's a different qualifier than the $1,000 exemption.
Much different.
Yes. So this covers more than
the previous exemption is a statutory exemption. Statutory exemptions are available to persons such as elderly, surviving spouses, disabled veterans, blind, et cetera, people that fit into those. And those are outlined by the state. The state sets the qualifying criteria. We're allowed to make some minor changes to those, and that gives us the authority to qualify people for them and grant the exemptions. This is an income tax credit for seniors that do file income taxes. And as Bob said, my reluctance at looking at this was, well, there might be reasons why some seniors don't file income taxes or don't receive the circuit breaker off their income taxes, which is beyond my purview. It would make it much easier if I wasn't the arbiter of whether or not they could receive it. Let's stick to, well, did you receive it? Mm. And that would make the process, at least on my end, pretty clearer for folks. If you get this, you might qualify for this.
And you might incentivize people to apply,
exactly,
who otherwise, sure, wouldn't.
Exactly.
And they might receive an additional benefit that they otherwise didn't know was out there.
Your question is, are they eligible, full stop? And if,
yep,
they're eligible, then we go forward.
Yep.
Yep.
If there's a joint owner must be at least 60 years of age. The applicant, the joint owner, must have resided in the town for at least 10 years. And in their property value, the assessed value of the domicile is no greater than the prior year's average assessed value of a single family plus 10%.
That's of the town, or
that would be of Sudbury's value. I don't know, last year our average single family value was just about 500,000. I think that tends to limit the applicant pool, considering where property values are going here, and maybe again adhering to circuit breaker program. The house value is 693, which, you know, even if you take five, add 50,000, add 10% to it, it still could inhibit some people who are house rich and cash poor.
Say that again, Victor. So you said the circuit breaker threshold is 693K.
Yes.
Above that, you don't get it.
That's right.
Below that, you're eligible.
Yep.
To
edible.
This language actually has strikes an even lower threshold.
In Sudbury.
In Sudbury. This,
right,
is, oh, Sudbury
centric. You have to normalize it for Sudbury.
Well, then there's that too.
Yeah.
This may be 110% of Sudbury, or even less.
Yeah,
yes,
I don't know what,
yes,
Sudbury's average,
yes,
single family value was at the inception of this back in,
yeah,
I think, 2013.
Yeah.
So there's a bunch of levers here that we can tune.
Yes.
Yeah.
What else did I want to say about that? The amount that they shift in the tax rate for the exemption is a percentage of tax levy. They either use 0.5% or 1% of tax levy. And that's governed by, if a lot of people apply, I, as the assessor, can reduce the amount of the exemption to stay under that cap. So we're talking about, you know, how much do we want to set aside and its effect on the residential rate, because the distribution will be controlled by me. The language gives the assessor that authority to say,
mm-hmm,
gee, you know what, if you're beyond the cap, you can lower the amount.
Right.
So
basically the folks who qualify will get something. They just might not get the maximum amount under the statute. We'll never spend above the amount of money that we're going to do.
Yes.
Because otherwise now we're shifting more
otherwise
to people, and it's an unknown factor.
You have no end game. You don't know.
Right. Exactly. Okay.
And on the other side, if there's excess cap, forever to say it, the criteria to award are all fixed. There's no vehicle where you
go above it,
where the payout is greater than, because you have fewer applicants.
No, the cap exists so you don't go over it.
But
right,
if you're underneath the cap, say the cap's at 1%,
yeah,
do your math, you're at 0.9, hey, there's another tenth of a percent.
Don't spend it.
I just don't spend it.
You need a mid-level exception. You have to do a salary dump of a sixth stringer on basketball.
Now, what... How could this possibly look like when you're talking about tax shifting and all that stuff? Let's see here.
Mm-hmm.
Make that a little bigger, maybe.
Lower right corner, there's a slide bar.
Lower right corner.
A little higher.
A little higher.
On the white portion.
Ah, there we go.
Heads in the way, I can't see.
There you go.
Hey, now. Okay. In this example, we're using our fiscal 16 data, and for the purposes of discussion, $1 million is what we're gonna shift. Because if we base this on circuit breaker recipients, the last circuit breaker filing, I think for 2015, had about 650 people from Reading receive the circuit breaker. Not all of those are homeowners, renters under certain circumstances could be eligible to receive it. But our candidate pool could be up to 650. Over the same period, Sudbury's was 240. And as far as exemptions granted for Sudbury, it was about 120.
It's about half.
Yeah. I'm not saying it's a reliable metric for us. That's all I have to go on. But here we have our tax levy and our single tax rate of $14.51. Because this works similar to a residential exemption, whereby the shift is within the residential side of the tax rate, I have to manipulate the residential exemption component of the recap sheet to come out with something. And the closest I can get it to over here, it says exemption cap, $999,873. So that's the pool we're playing with. Now, how does that affect the tax rate? As you can see here, at a factor of 1, our single tax rate, commercial, industrial, personal property would continue to be $14.51 per thousand. Residential tax rate would be $14.76. So, in order to reserve $1 million of exemption cap to be distributed to elderly in Reading under this scenario, it would cost residential taxpayers 25 cents per thousand. And obviously, if you look at shifting or what have you, that can bring those numbers closer.
So the simple math is that million divided by the residential component. That's about 44. What's the residential levy only?
The residential.
What fraction of the 62 million is residential?
91.75.
So around
56, 55.
Yeah. So you're talking about, it's 1/55, so you're a little under 2% of the increase in the residential tax rate.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And then if you shift it with the commercial, it'll reduce by 8/8, it'll drop another 8%.
I think Bob, in one of his memos to me while shaving, figured a 1.023% shift. One of the things when we talk about this, if we look at shifting some of the tax burden between commercial and residential, I'm begging you fellas, please let's stick to round numbers.
Yeah. So did you do any kind of iterations where, let's say we as a board say it's good public policy that we want to try to assist seniors to, you know, stay in their homes and and let's say we're going to designate $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did you do any sort of back testing to see if we also said, as a fairness method, we were going to say that $1 million would get split equally between the commercial class and the residential class. So 500,000 from the residential class, 500,000 from the business class. What would that do to the tax rates?
Well, or
to the CI, to the factors.
If you wanted to split that in half,
say we're, as a town, we all think it's important to support our seniors, and we're all going to share in that equally. What would the factors be? Because I try to figure it out here,
and
my head
explodes. This one, I know if we reserved, I'll tell you what. If we reserved $1.5 million cap to do this, the shift factor would be 1.14. So in this scenario, for $1 million cap, you're looking at, what, a 7, 1.08.
So rounding up.
1.1.
110 to 150.
Yeah, well, yes.
2/3 of 114.
So 110 or 115.
Yes.
If you went to the higher figure.
Yep.
Okay. So,
yeah, those are on other spreadsheets that I looked
okay.
at. Hey, you might want to know this, might want to know that.
I was trying to figure it out off of this.
Yeah.
I couldn't.
That's when we send this to you, you'll have a ball. Your wife may hate you at the time, but
no,
you know what? Yeah. Under the same scenario for a 1.5 million shift, let's get right down to the meat of the issue, the tax rates. Again, commercial 1451. Residential tax rate would be 1489. So the difference there would be what the rest of the residential taxpayers would pay. That would be the residential rate.
Right. For a million and a half.
For everybody, yeah.
Assumption.
Yep. Now, let me see here. This one and this one. Now, what would that tax relief look like? Why do I have my glasses sitting over here when I should be wearing them? Okay. Boom.
Bigger numbers, please.
Oh, you're killing me.
That's fine.
Okay. Bob and I were talking about, well, gee, how would this impact, you know, Reading residents and what have you? And I said, well, why don't we just take the average assessed value and have different incomes. And you can see here that the way it works is last calendar year income, if they did get a circuit breaker credit, 10% plus the circuit breaker credit goes to that, so their taxes cannot exceed this.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other end, any exemption in taxes cannot decrease their overall tax obligation by more than 50%.
Okay.
So
it's you can take advantage of multiple programs, but you still can't pay less than 50% of what you normally would have paid.
Yes.
Okay.
And this is where we would manipulate this 10% if we had an abundance of folks and we had to knock it down to 8% or 7% to stay within the cap. This would be the column that we do it in.
What is that? I'm not getting what that factor is. What does that mean?
This is the exemption in this scenario. Can't exceed, what is this? Why am I drawing a blank?
Is that where you're trying to scale it to stand at a cap?
Is it 25% of income?
That's yes. That's the percent. 10% of the income is what's used in order to receive the circuit breaker. If you pay 10% or more of your income towards taxes, you can qualify for the circuit breaker as long as you meet the other income and property value requirements as stipulated. So that's how we would justify. We would make it, you know, 11 or 12% of income to come beneath the cap that we set. Ooh, sorry, that was word garbage.
So the point is, you discussed a year ago a residential exemption as an indirect way and a reasonable way of getting at this issue. This is as direct as this is looking at the ratio of how many property taxes you pay versus your income. What could be more direct?
And obviously the 10, 11, 12% is within our purview to set each year, I suppose.
He does that.
The 10% is based on the circuit breaker, 10% of income to arrive at what we're going to use for the base calculation.
Okay.
Once we do this, we can't adjust our figures for at least 3 years of
the
home
rule
petition.
Will have to state X number of $1 million or X percent of the tax levy is your ceiling, your cap. Now, what we're not sure is, and I'm not sure there's a reason you do this, you could have one number in the first year, a different number in the second year. I wouldn't suggest it. I think that's legal, though.
I mean,
but then he will determine what these numbers need to be in order to stay within that cap.
I mean, broad-based language could give us the leeway to, you know, we want to do anything from either 5%, a half a percent to a percent, which would give me the leeway to say, okay, this is how many people we had last year. Maybe we need to go up to 0.75% or 1% of the tax levy.
So, Victor, earlier the slide you showed about the income requirements for someone to qualify for the Sudbury program, and those were the same income requirements that the
for the circuit breaker.
So, obviously, we don't want to keep reinventing a program if we've got something that works. But also, in reading the Sudbury material, it looks like they had a pretty onerous asset requirement as well. So, for example, you could, you know, might have lower income, but you might have higher assets. Is that reflected here anywhere?
I don't think it is, because my opinion was we wanted to keep them out of that business and not have an asset test. But obviously, that's your call.
Well, I mean, the reason why I bring it up is that, you know, you could have somebody that is, you know, who relies, let's say, on a trust fund for income or an annuity. Or something where their income isn't high, but yet they have, you know, substantial assets which they could draw on to pay their property taxes, whereas maybe someone else doesn't have that. So I guess the question though is,
do you want to go above and beyond what the state has for an asset test?
Because
then we have to administer.
I'm not sure what I want to do other than the fact that reserve the money for the people who need it the most. And if, you know, if someone's going to qualify based on income, and those are pretty liberal income. I mean, there are working families who make less than
59,000.
So it was 70,000, I think.
But remember the age also, and the years in rent.
Right.
Which you set both of those.
I'll leave it at this. I wouldn't be opposed to some type of asset test. You know, we already have to go through assets for first-time filers when they file for the senior exemption. We can do the same for first-time filers for this, and we can set an arbitrary number that you can't have more than X amount of dollars. We can cap it, you know.
So, Victor, could you comment on the application process that the average resident would go through to?
Okay.
Yeah. How onerous would it be?
I'd make it as simple as possible, but in doing so, it would be a very early application process.
Right.
Something whereby roughly the month of August, that by the end of August we would have all the applications in, if not sooner, because once the applications come in, we have to test them to make sure that they qualify. And then once they qualify, then we begin using those numbers to compute the tax rate. So it would be an early application process. It would be, you know, probably standard type homegrown form, documenting, you know, ownership. If we have assets, requesting, you know, bank statements, things of that nature.
Do they have to produce tax returns?
Requesting the prior year's tax returns.
State to state?
Well, their income tax return to show that they...
Both state and federal.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we have a clear understanding of what their total income is, and then plug all that stuff into a spreadsheet.
You know, if their house is, let's say that is owner-occupied, they fit all the... But they put their house in a trust. Do they qualify? They don't own the house. The trust...
There's a lot of folks who do that. In vivo trusts.
And I go through this with statutory exemption applicants.
Mm-hmm.
They have to be a trustee...
And a beneficiary.
And have beneficial interest.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But most often when people come to me, I tell them, gee, they paid a professional good money to ensure that their wishes be adhered to. Don't change a trust just to qualify for, you know, what are now small exemptions. Don't risk your family's financial future to do it.
So the owned and occupied criteria is met by being a trustee with a beneficial interest in the property.
Yes. Or a life estate, life tenancy.
Mm-hmm.
But the end result, looking over.
Well, what if they have a reverse mortgage? I just thought.
Doesn't count.
Doesn't count.
So if you have a reverse mortgage, you won't qualify.
Does not. No, doesn't count for the purposes of
surprise
receiving the exemption.
Oh.
For example, with the statutory exemption, all you did was cash in on some equity of your home vis-a-vis a reverse mortgage. Your home value is excluded for the purposes of the statutory exemption.
Oh, I see.
Your reverse mortgage funds would not be used for this. But right here, where we have the fiscal 16 exemption amount in Munis, this person's tax bill was $7,372. We're taking off $3,686. Folks right below who had a very healthy income, only getting about $124 off. And so on and so forth down the line. Sudbury's result of the exemption, most people receive between $2,500 and $3,500 off.
Imagine their average tax bill is 10 grand or more.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you thought there'd be about 600 and some odd families that might qualify?
Well,
I mean, it's hard to say until you.
Once we start rolling out a program like this,
there'll
we
be
had
at least 2,000
that think they would qualify.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
If you subsidize something, you get more of it.
And that's something we discussed with John Halsey is that, the 650. Some of them probably rent, some of them won't qualify. How many more didn't apply for the state because it was $1,000 and maybe they didn't know or maybe they didn't care? But for $3,500, it becomes a different incentive.
Where my head's at on this,
there's no way to know.
You probably have to do something different in year one just to figure out where you land. You probably won't get it right in one move. You'll have to do it
right.
In two moves.
And you'd almost assume that, you know, year two you might actually have
real data.
Yeah.
Well, not even real data, but you also, I think they'll have a whole list of returning and new applicants that will qualify.
What was Sudbury's findings? What were their surprises? Do you remember? I remember talking about
They didn't know how to handle folks that received a tax deferral because technically they had no tax obligation last year. And I'm thinking, well, that's silly. If they had a tax obligation.
They have a tax liability. They just haven't paid it.
Defer it. Why don't you just use it?
We can defer the rebate, too.
But yeah, really. There was some, that was one of the biggest unintended consequences of this. And they're still learning. They've had 3 years doing this. The report they gave us, which we'd be happy to forward to you, summarizes 2 years of it. They were recently reapproved for another 3 years. I think the State Department of Revenue is watching the results closely, although they haven't been a tremendous help to Sudbury.
I better say it, you better not. You have to deal with them.
No, I've asked my peers who've looked at this in other communities like Concord, Billerica, other, you know, communities of our town. And they seem to look at it with like one eyebrow raised. There doesn't seem to be a groundswell of support among my most eminent peers, and not necessarily from folks who, I don't want to try anything new, I'm afraid to do this. People who are curious about, they want a few more years of data. They want, you know,
sure,
the unintended consequences to be rectified.
Sure.
And preferably the state to embrace it.
And I first heard of this sometime, I think it was March of last spring. And I've talked to two of our legislatures at that period, one of our reps and our senator. And I said, why don't you just roll this out across the state? Because there's a lot of communities having the same issue. And I guess there now is some effort. I'm sure it's years away, but there is some effort at making state legislation. It's not going to help us for at least a few years, though. And when Sudbury reapplied to make theirs permanent, the DOR said no. I think they got 2 years.
Oh.
They got either 2 or 3 years.
But they can reapply as another home rule. So, I mean, it's curious. We're doing this as a kind of, as part of a discussion on a general override. You know, we might not have thought about this if we were just, you know, going along. But, you know, as we started talking about the override and, you know, who is it going to hurt, who is it going to impact, that's what kind of started the discussion amongst us about, you know, what are some of the things we can do to mitigate some of the negative impacts. So when Sudbury did it, was that part, what, they just sort of, did an override trigger that discussion?
They've been overriding every 3 years. Whoops, did I say that?
And then the corollary to that is that, you know, is this tax policy we would want to consider, you know, even if we, if an override didn't pass, or if, even if an override wasn't even on the table, is this the kinds of things that, you know, we would want to think about doing, you know, I mean, obviously we're doing it as part of an override, but, you know, is this a standalone thing potentially? And
Another community that does something is Wayland.
Mm.
And basically they have a circuit breaker match. If you qualify for the circuit breaker, we're going to match it.
Mm.
Downfall for us, where we're looking at, you know, huge questions down the road about what we want to do financially for the town, is that that comes from the overlay. The town pays for it.
Oh, interesting.
This is revenue neutral to the town.
Right.
Taxpayers,
deferred,
the other
taxpayers. Basically, what you're doing is that you're just shifting the deck a little bit.
Yes.
Right.
The cards in the deck.
Fewer wallets.
Right.
And
I thought the overlay was only for abatements and that sort of thing.
And exemptions, which that would be
an
exemption.
Oh, okay.
And that definition also covers people that don't necessarily own property. I mean, it's taxpayers.
True.
Right. You could be renting.
Real
could
property.
Be renting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think it would.
You don't have it. You don't own a property.
Yeah, but Wayland.
Well, no,
no,
it would be for homeowners. The match would be for homeowners.
Okay.
Yeah, if you rent a home and, hey, wait a second.
Right.
There's another criteria.
Home ownership is the key criteria.
Perhaps
for a certain length of time, 10 years, hint. I will say this has been a tremendous exercise for me, putting it mildly. But
is Wakefield going to do it after us?
I just talked to him today. He wants a briefing on it. Thanks, Bob.
Their demographics are probably a lot similar to ours, I would think, aren't they?
I don't know, honestly.
Coming here, I said, oh, houses are the same. Both Capes of Cape, Capes of Cape, all this stuff here. No, I could have been more wrong. The differences from just, you know, a mile away. The neighborhood structure, the land structure, and property value. Wise.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I come here and it's, I'm surprised I have any hair left. I'm usually scratching my head going, that's for what?
Welcome to my world.
Yeah, exactly.
But just for those in the audience, we got here, as Barry said, you know, necessity is the mother of invention, and our desire was to find a way in an environment where an override was in the foreseeable future to provide some cushion for those seniors that wanted to stay in their home. And provide other forms of relief that we could within the state guidelines. This is one of them, and as you can see, you need a CPE, you need a CPA degree, and a couple years of financial analysis to figure it out. It's, I'm sure in practice it'll be very easy to roll out, but part of the dialogue here is for us to wrap our heads around it so we can understand the sensitivity, the application, the cost, and as Victor's already said, the unintended consequences. None of these changes, when you make them, come for nothing. There's always a, oh, we didn't know about that, that occurs a year or two down the road, and then you've got to try to fix it.
One of the chart I did, you know, every year I show that bar chart of how many properties below 500,000.
Yep.
Well, what I did was take a couple of median values over here of those commercial properties. So of the 81 properties under $500,000, the median value is 3018. At a single tax rate, and this exemplifies the $1 million cap. At a single tax rate, their taxes would have been, you know, 43.40. Put these on, Vic.
43.79.
Yeah. If you shift it just to 1.1%, you have an increase of $40. And to 2% is another little bit there. The break-even point, as someone had asked earlier, is approximately 10%. So if you were to see what shifting half of that $1 million cap to commercial properties would do, that will put us right around a 10% shift with a residential tax rate of 1463 and a commercial tax rate of 1596.
Which is still well below the average of the commercial tax rates of towns around here.
Yes.
Well below.
But
I
tried to anticipate if a question would come up, well, what if they wanted to split that in half with commercial? So that's basically what it would be. And then the $1.5 million example, it's basically 15%.
You're not following the math. We've always said it's a 10 to 1, or in this case, 12 to 1 ratio. So 10% on residential should have 120% on the commercial.
But your residential is close to 92%. Your commercial is only 8.
So if it's up 10% on the residential, why is the rate at the end only a few pennies difference, 15 versus 14? Maybe I'm asking the question
wrong. Not quite. It's probably, 8% higher, I suppose.
Yeah.
But shouldn't it be much more because of the 12 to 1 ratio of commercial to residential?
Well, I'm only...
it's based on the valuation. That's our number of problems.
But the valuation of commercial is 1/12 that of residential, right?
Well, if you
look... the single tax rate, is that shown on this? It isn't. The single tax rate would be...
1451.
Just barely above the residential,
yes.
with a 1.0, and then it leaps up on commercial at a ratio of 92 to 8,
right?
Versus residential. So that 1596 at the bottom has gone up by quite a bit versus what the residential has gone down by that ratio.
Yeah, because the residential with no shift is 1476, with a 10% shift. Mm-hmm. And the exemption is only 1463.
I'm not getting this. I need to stay.
Yeah, that's a good one to show. Show that in the column. I
no shift.
This is the senior exemption, so the rates are different.
I look at the cell formulas.
So you start with 1476 on residential.
That's a 1-to-1. 1476.
1476 and 1451 are a 1.0.
Right. So
with
the residential tax
would
be
higher
shifted? With no shift.
Right.
Yes,
correct. You've basically had the rest of the homeowners
have to pay.
So
that's the effective tax rate. Right.
And even if you were to do a 10% shift to commercial, which again takes about half that $1 million value, residential is still paying, about 12 cents more than it otherwise would have without an exemption and a single tax rate.
That's probably where that. So the difference in the billing would be $1.30 in the tax rate between the two. It's not huge.
Can you distribute this, Victor, this worksheet?
Yeah,
I may have sent it to you.
Did you send it to all of us?
Yeah, I think so.
It was sent.
Oh, I didn't see it.
Well, all right. You wouldn't, so many spreadsheets, it would be hard to find.
Oh, is that the one that said spreadsheets?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. No, I see.
This was after the weekend of just doing nothing and coming in yesterday going, okay, here's the spreadsheets.
Okay, I
that
didn't get to this one. I'll take
we can cut to
four spreadsheets
the,
in a
get snapshot.
Okay.
I mean, behind the scenes, Bob can get spreadsheets out to you and bring on the questions, folks.
Right, so this one and this 1.1 are the ropes at the bottom and top of that. You can go past that point, right? That's where that 1.1 is.
Oh, I can go, I could take it all out.
You can take it as far as you 1. Want.
1.5, I could, 1. Yeah.
5.
I figured too many increments would be too much to try to fit.
So Sudbury's the only...
only one that does.
Only one in the state. They got a 2-year permission on the home rule.
Mm-hmm.
And you think they can get that renewed.
They already did. They had 2 years. It was recently renewed for 3 more years, which kind of tells me the state may not be... moving swiftly to devise its own means tested exemption.
So this is
a guinea pig. They want to see how it turns out.
Sure.
This is bleeding edge stuff. This isn't leading edge. This is leading edge.
Right. Yeah. This is good stuff. I'd be inclined to entertain this. It'd be where my head would be at, would be looking at examining the years in town. They've got 10 in there. I'd be inclined to maybe want to bump that up a bit.
Yeah.
More?
That's it. Beyond 10. I mean, you also have to try to find some commonality with existing exemptions. For example, some senior exemptions you know, may have to have been domiciled in Massachusetts for 5 years or 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
So the structuring of it is kind of consistent with other ones out there. But what I do favor is maybe not a percent of the tax levy, but a fixed dollar amount, maybe with a moving target.
A range.
You know, yeah.
Where the range would move the more applicants and you'd stay within that range.
Well, a range of between, you know, a million and 1.5 million for round numbers.
And where did you arrive at those two figures for? Was that just based on what other towns have been doing?
Well, if you do 1% of the tax levy, that's only about
$620,000. Okay.
You know, and considering we may
so
have
1.5 is like 2.5% of the levy.
On the other hand,
yeah.
Sudbury started very conservatively and
yeah.
said, let's do 0.5% in year one and see what happens, and then we might go as high as 1% in year two.
Right.
So the other side of conservatism is let's walk before we run and see what we end up with.
Oh, sure. I agree. But also, you know, if you're trying to make this as widely available, I'd hate to have my pants pockets turned out at the
right.
the last bunch of applicants.
So we can word it in such a way,
yeah.
between 1 million and 1.5 million and
fix them up.
Or whatever,
right.
you know, fixed amount you feel comfortable with.
What's the minimum that you'd set it for? 1 year? Or would you set it for 2 years?
Go for two.
Over a petition,
I'd go
three.
Yeah, I want to go three.
Yeah.
So you have 3 years of means testing.
And then you have some data you could
look
at.
And then you could
look
at it and
yeah.
kind of adjust it as needed.
And there's kind of like a catch-all that you'll trust the assessor to handle things appropriately within the spirit for the intended recipients. Like if there is an unintended consequence that comes up, you know, I'd apprise you of it, but I'd also say this is the remedy for it that we've been employing over the second year and third year until we have to redo it again and incorporate it. So
what happens in year four if you have to make changes? How do you make assuming you have to make a major change?
I said we had to redo the home rule petition process. And I think they spent 6 to 12 months just to renew it internally.
Yeah.
And if there's no state program available, we'd do the same.
So, I mean, the worst thing that could happen is, let's say we do it, we get it through the legislature, and then for some reason they have a changing of the mind, and now they don't renew it. People who might have come to be, you know, expect to get a $25,000 or $3,000 tax cut now have to go full boat, and
yeah.
that could be devastating.
Yeah.
That's also an unintended consequence. If we do something like this,
and the rug gets pulled out,
and the
yeah,
state
that's a
decides to come up with
sure.
its own means-tested exemption that's
mm-hmm.
more applicable, more cities and
yeah.
towns are in it, then, you know, we might want to go with a state-sponsored program as opposed to our
right.
homegrown
one.
Which
would impact the grants.
Do you know what the participation numbers were in Sudbury?
Sudbury, again, they had about 240.
What, you know, their total?
Yeah.
What's the size of the town?
Oh, I don't have that.
Is it bigger than Reading?
Small.
Yeah, go ahead.
But 135 1 year,
I think about
125 the next year.
Okay.
So how many qualified and how many applied? Do you know this?
Doesn't tell me.
I don't think we have the data for Reading.
Yeah.
Are there any questions from the audience on any of this?
When do we apply?
Jeez.
We know you'll be first in line.
So, Bill, this is part of the override. So, you know.
Well, it's actually going to town meeting.
It's actually
potentially. We're talking about it in a brand new.
Now, the plan would be to bring this article to town meeting, but not
first, then ask for the override.
Yeah.
I think you get a better result.
All right.
It's about seniors who are veterans.
Say that again?
Who are veterans. They get a little extra bump.
It's up to you how the question is worded.
Actually, that's an interesting.
We've talked about it.
You can't go nuts.
Yeah.
You can't.
No.
It can't be a panacea for everything. You know, the little bit of fine-tuning that we have available to us, so can't limit or select. Being a veteran myself, I'd love to. Come on in. You get first-line treatment, trust me. Carte blanche.
Yeah,
if you qualify.
John Halsey put it to town council, and I also did, on his behalf, that how would you word an article that would allow the selectmen and the town flexibility to implement this when an override passes instead of at any old time? And so that's the instruction town council's been given. You can always change that.
Well, can you just not submit the home rule petition until after the vote?
No, because of the process is too slow, so we want to submit it. So you can pass a home rule petition, for instance, that says, upon the passage of a Prop 2.5 override, the town will blah, blah, blah. And that's perfectly fine. But you need to discuss as a board, is that really what your intentions? That's always been the discussion, is how can we help tax relief? Now, what you've seen today is probably more tax relief than any of us had imagined for some people in town.
Certainly.
It's not just to remove the effect of an override, it's to remove a lot more than the effect of an override.
So this is pretty much taking the place of our discussion on the residential exemption, which was sort of a surrogate for doing this, but this is much more focused on incomes.
This has got much more meat on it to, the people who most need it.
And the amount of relief is much greater than just the override.
Yeah.
You've got many more tools here.
But I mean, the way we could maybe change that is just maybe change some of the income guidelines, then, right?
Within the limits, yeah.
Maybe you could set a cap on total.
Tax relief.
Total tax relief, too, because, you know, the unintended consequences
you
mentioned.
I mean, 50% of someone's tax bill, that's more than what an override.
Once you do something, you can't undo it. Mayor of Everett years ago put in a residential exemption. Mm. Everybody got $1,000 off their own occupied properties. And it got into his head, no, the commercial properties are paying for it. He did away with it.
Uh-huh.
He was mayor for 2 years.
Yeah.
Because everybody that got reduction, $1,000 the first year, the next year had to pay back $1,000 to their escrows that got it. And so Mayor Hanlon learned the hard way. You don't do that. Wherever you are.
Mr. Chair, did you want to have a conversation on this tonight, or did you just want to?
That is just phase one.
I think it's just good information to pick up for at a later meeting.
Well, we'll be picking this up in our next meeting again.
Yeah, okay. I think we're going to have a full board at the next meeting.
Good.
All right.
Is it
the intention then at our next meeting that we're really going to sort of finalize
You have to finalize on August 9th the language of this question. Which will mean all the different levers you want to pull or not, whether you want to make a contingent on an override, and how long you want to have it last. Because town council then has to work between the 9th and the 16th, I think those are the dates of your next 2 weeks, to get you language that you can approve to close the warrant.
What should be our target for getting to a final override question? I'm suggesting that happen in August, if prior to the September 1st meeting.
I think you should have it at the very latest on August 16th when you meet with the school committee. Listen to what they have to say, and I'll have given you some prep work on the
And there'll be some options presented in that meeting for how the questions can go. I mean, I think John.
It's up to you. I know you've asked for that.
Yeah, John and you, and maybe I will work on helping you craft those.
Yeah.
Maybe I can look at examples of a capped exemption amount, say $1,500, and kind of work that back. Some type of income level, because if you means tested is by, you know, by income. If we throw income out, I guess the question is, could we still do a fixed amount exemption, shifting it? I mean, the DOR would answer my call if I asked.
Yeah, the DOR would never. Well, they wouldn't want you to do that. It's hard to know what they could actually accomplish.
I think you want to leave the income in, and best put the cap in.
Yeah,
and income's a funny thing. I mean, you look at, I spend my day looking at people's tax returns, and, you know, income, there's income and there's cash flow. And, you know, there are things that mitigate income on a tax return that don't necessarily mitigate someone's cash flow. So, you know, I think what we're looking at really is helping the people who truly are struggling to pay their property taxes. Which means that we have to be sort of forensic CPAs. It makes it difficult. I want to make it simple, but I also want to just do our best to make sure that this is going to people who really need it. You know, or the maximum amount will go to the people who need it the most. there's got to be an easy way to sort of figure that out.
One of the litmus tests the board has talked about previously, although we didn't know this all existed, was trying to help people who bought their house a number of years ago at a much different lower value and have grown into a higher tax bill without necessarily growing into any more income. And that's the benefit of having this 10-year or 15 or 20-year, whatever you choose.
That's not just seniors. That's, you know, that could
be
a lot of...
Well, for this, it would
be
seniors,
right,
but yeah.
That's a lot of people in town.
Yeah.
The three kids that went to Birch Meadow are now at college, and their incomes didn't go up, and their tax bill, and their value went up.
It didn't go up proportionally to someone who paid $20,000 for their house, though.
Right.
You know, 45, 50 years ago. How much did you buy your house for? Never mind.
$6,500 I built my house for, thank
okay.
you. Including the land.
There you go.
56.
I'll communicate. Anything else we do vis-a-vis spreadsheets, I'll get them to Bob, and any kind of other thoughts that I have on those levers, get them to you.
Yeah, Victor just showed you one example, but he's got, you know, infinite capacity to, you know, he split the commercial into five groups and described one of them to you.
Mm.
You know, we don't want to do a sound bite, but it's sometimes helpful to just visually see the impact on different things.
Right.
You know, this commercial group, that residential group, you know, whatever. You know, you're at the policy level, but now you're going to quickly move over to how does this impact real people and real businesses.
All right. Thank you very much,
Victor.
Victor,
thank you so much for putting this together. This is
and Bob.
What you want?
And Joe.
Yeah. My head's going to explode. It really is.
Should have seen me by Thursday last week. Have a good evening, gentlemen.
Right,
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Paul.
Good work.
I think we have some minutes to approve. And I had a change I had sent out to Paul on the first one.
Yeah, I've got one too.
All right. June
21st, July 12th.
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of June 21st, 2016 as amended.
Second. I have some. I'd like to add an explanatory line on page 2. Prior to my motion to reconsider, or actually as a clause, just to explain for readers, future readers of the minutes, why we did it. On the sentence under appoint boards and committees, Dan Ensminger moved to reconsider. I want to add the phrase, to comply with the Reading bylaw requirement that associate terms be for 2 years, not 1 year, comma, Dan Ensminger moved.
Yeah.
So to comply with the Reading bylaw requirement that associate terms be for 2 years, not 1 year. I'd like to add that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anything else on that, on the 21st? All in favor? Amended? 4-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of July 12th, 2016 as amended. Second.
Yep, second.
All right, so I only have just one. It's on the first page there. There's a clerical error that no one fixed when I was speaking. It just referenced that I was at a CBDC meeting. I was attending the CBDC meeting the whole time. I meant to say the ZBA meeting.
No.
I corrected myself long after the fact that it was already written down. So that's
okay.
The only amendment I had. It's on the fourth paragraph on the first page there. Anything else?
So.
Okay. All those in favor, as amended? 4-0. Unless there's anything else, gentlemen, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move. You got it.
Move to the Board of Selectmen to adjourn the meeting at 9:12.
Yeah.
Second.
All in favor? 4-0.
Good night.
Night.
Good evening.
Thanks, everyone.
Okay.
So how much time do we cut off the meeting without policy?
I'll duly note that.
At least an hour.
Leave us over here so we can drive around.